thank you very much for the opportunity to present our work. My name is Frank Minja. I'm a new radiologist, not from the UK, so I might be the odd one here, but I really appreciate your attention and staying out. This is one of the last sessions, but we are super excited to share our work with you. This presentation has been condensed from 60 minutes to 30 minutes to 10 minutes, and I've been asked to do this in 7 minutes. So you're going to get basically a CNN version of this process, and it's literally a two-year project. I'm going to try to summarize in 10 minutes or less. However, if you kind of get lost, there is a little road to IR, hashtag road to IR on Twitter, or at road to IR on Instagram and Facebook, and there's a lot more information that you can find there, and it's probably more enjoyable because there's a lot of pictures. I do want to recognize Fabian Agup. If you just want to stand up, he's my partner in this project, and he is a third-year resident. We work together very closely in this project. So without further ado, no financial disclosures. We already know where Tanzania is. We're merely south of Kenya and Uganda. And where we work is in Dar es Salaam. That is the commercial capital. That's about 6 million people. The whole country of Tanzania is about 55 to 60 million people. And we work mainly in Dar es Salaam because that's where the main national referral hospital is, and also that's where the medical university is. So the outline of the talk is going to basically kind of give you the background of it, the plan, the training, and the results. So basically, this is the take-home slide, just to kind of give you some context as to why we even began doing this work. So again, as alluded before, we're in a similar situation to Uganda, but quite a little bit worse. We basically need 100 times more radiologists to basically fulfill the WHO recommended ratio, which is about 100 radiologists for 1 million people. So we're basically batting around 1 radiologist for 1 million people. And that is not an accident. I put those years there. Those years actually mean a lot. I don't have time to go into them. But roughly, we had independence in 1961. And immediately after independence, we had 2 radiologists. And basically, the next 3 decades, we didn't really train any radiologists in the country because the country focused more on training lower cadres of medical specialists, mostly clinical officers. And we kind of picked up again in the 2000s. And this is after basically going through the structural adjustment programs, which basically cut again funding to higher education. So basically, where we are is a product of many, many years, actually 5 decades of underinvestment in training and so forth. So here we are going to come in, and we want to establish an interventional radiology training program in Tanzania, because that is what we were asked to do by the executive director of the National Hospital. But the first thing to do was basically to assess, is it even feasible to do? So one of the first steps that we did with Fabian, he came in 2017 October trip, and he did a radiology net readiness assessment, which is a very detailed survey that looks at every aspect of the facility to answer one question: is it feasible to establish an interventional radiology training program in your facility? And the answer was basically yes, and this is just a quick picture showing you a state-of-the-art facility. This facility is a replica of a facility in Seoul, South Korea, like brick for brick and all the way down to the equipment. Literally, if you walk into this hospital, it's actually really super fancy. It has all of the equipment in there. It's a really beautiful facility. And so basically, in terms of facilities, we have all the facilities. What's missing here, or the big difference between here and Seoul, South Korea, is that in South Korea, you actually are going to have hundreds of super specialized folks treating patients in that fancy building, in which case in Tanzania, that is actually not the case. So we have the equipment. Now we actually have to bring the specialists. And the equipment is basically just summarized here. Many ultrasound machines, a fluoroscopy machine, an awesome CT scan. And so the main two things that we're lacking was basically opportunities for training and basically disposable equipment. And I cannot emphasize the lack of opportunities for training. And I was really happy to hear that the Royal College in the UK have many opportunities for our physicians to pursue and do actual training. Because really, it's really sad when I know that physicians who are willing to pay out of pocket to get training, and there's just no opportunities. And one for a fact is trying to get a visa in Singapore, and was not given a visa, even though they're able to actually pay out of pocket for that training. So this is where we kind of came in, and we were basically going to focus on training physicians, and also basically dealing with the supply and equipment. So we already had the major machines, we just had to do supply logistics, and so this is going to be two problems you have to sort of like deal with. But in between, we realized that when you're doing procedures, as Greg alluded, you need somebody to monitor the patients while you're doing these mini surgeries. So you have to train the nurse, and you need technology that's actually going to help you be very efficient. So eventually, I mean, when we started the program, we had to make sure they were training a physician, nurse, and technology all at the same time. So our teams are usually a minimum of three people for that team. And this is how it was basically planned. So immediately, we're going to address the immediate need. That includes like abscess drainage, nephrostomy tubes, biliary drainage, and so forth, and not no really like vascular cases. And then basically build this program over phase two and phase three. So roughly, these are the really life-saving procedures that you need to get immediately. So core biopsy allows you to get an adequate sample in order to diagnose cancer. And abscess drainage is just, imagine if you have like a ruptured appendicitis, right now you're gonna have an open laparotomy to like wash out the abscess instead of putting a small tube to drain out the abscess. So that's how we're gonna basically build out this program moving forward. So what does it actually look like? So it's actually a 2 weeks on and 2 weeks off process. This is actually how the schedule looks like. I've actually know this schedule by heart right now. So basically I work all the week till Friday evening and I take the last flight out of JFK, which is 11 p.m. on Emirates. It lands me into Dubai, 8 p.m. on Saturday night. I sleep over there to get over the jet lag. The next morning I wake up is Sunday, that's 10 a.m. on Sunday. I catch a flight to Tanzania at 3 p.m. in Tanzania. And that is what most of the teams that arrive on that Sunday. I arrive on Sunday, Monday to Friday is a work week, very busy work week. There are many, many sick patients. And it's obviously very difficult and challenging to do these cases. So we end up doing 4 or 5 cases a day when we are in that schedule. They have a beautiful break in between, which is basically Friday afternoon through Sunday evening, where they get to visit some of the really highlights of on our bucket list. So that would be Zanzibar and Gorongoro Crater. And again, there's a well-oiled safari itinerary that gets you out of Dar es Salaam at 3 p.m. on Friday afternoon and back into Dar es Salaam on Sunday, 9 p.m. And you'll see Gorongoro Crater, you're gonna see Manyara National Park, which has awesome elephants. You come back on Monday to Friday, you're basically gonna grind again and do another 5 days of really hard clinical work. And then on the last day, we do a handoff call. So this has gone really well right now. We're basically on team 5 that just returned from April. And so we've basically successfully sent like 5 teams over. And the next team is gonna actually leave next weekend. And that's coming from MGH Harvard. And we're very happy and thankful that this has gone very successfully. But one thing I want you to notice here is that even though we have major institutions in the UK, not one single institution could do all of this, right? So right now, if I propose to my chair that please give me 10 of your physicians to come to my program, one of us is gonna get fired, either the IR physicians or me, right? So basically we need a lot of like cooperation to kind of get this done. So this is what it actually looks like. This was team one in October, so that's about 16 plus people. We had 8 diagnostic radiologists and 8 interventional radiologists, so a massive team in there. And this allowed us to basically stress test the teams to know that we can actually do this. I mean, you can imagine the amount of moving parts to kind of basically accommodate a 17, 18 people team in Dar es Salaam for 2 weeks. But knock on wood, that went well, and everybody got home safely. We took care of a lot of patients. This is in the early days. You can see myself and Fabian and the two trainees, Eric, Ivan, and Maza, and Kennedy is one of my new radiology fellows. We've since advanced right now. Here you see 3 trainees who are 3rd-year radiology residents, another 3 trainees who are 2nd-year radiology residents. And behind me is Dr. Polova from Emory, who's been a fantastic supporter of our program. So we make a lot of progress. This is Eric doing a core needle biopsy. Please note that Eric is holding the needle by himself, so he's actually getting hands-on training, and the other physician is just supervising him. This is another one who's doing like an abscess drainage. Again, he's holding the needle. He is actually doing the procedure. And he's receiving on real-time guidance from our trainer. This is Dr. Nima. This is, he had to do this case. It's very complicated. It was actually calling what is a pseudoaneurysm. So that big black thing in the middle of the screen is actually a pseudoaneurysm in a patient pancreatitis. This basically means is a artery that is waiting to rupture at any moment. And this will be lethal in Tanzania, in the US, in the UK. Basically, if you call 911 with this rupture, there's no ambulance that can get you fast enough into the angio suite. So this was really like a life-saving procedure that was done. Again, this is a shout out to hashtag nursing now. We actually have to train nurses while we're doing this. So you can see there we have Sister Brigitte and Sister Rose who have been trained by our nurse Janine. And we also train the technologists, and that is on the right side, there's Chris from Canada training Fabian, one of our techs, and he's training him how to set up the table so he can actually prepare for the procedure. None of us will be able to kind of do that training while we're also training the residents. So it's very important to have colleagues in multi-specialties be part of our teams. So what are the results so far? So we're very proud that we've actually performed more, almost 100 procedures, actually exactly 100 procedures up to like team 5, and we have zero major complications. But what we're really most proud of is that basically 100% of our core biopsy samples were actually diagnosed. That is a big deal, right? So you will have a woman with obvious breast cancer, obvious lymphadenopathy, they will do what is called a fine needle aspiration, and it comes back with insufficient sample. And so instead of that, the surgeons will get so frustrated, they'll just go and do a large incision biopsy. So this is actually the basis of us being able to establish oncologic care and in cancer care in general. And so this is sort of the breakdown. You can see most of the cases of core needle biopsy, abscess drainage, pulmonary drainage, and nephrostomy. How do we actually make this happen? You might think that because we're coming from Yale, I have access to the large endowment that my institution has. The answer is no. Neither do we have access to the endowment from Emory. This is really a hodgepodge. It's people like you who will actually give to our fundraisings, raised about like $20,000, and that actually gave us the jumpstart to actually do this project. It cost about $5,000 to actually send 3 people to Dar es Salaam in terms of flights and also housing. And we're also very thankful that we had a good partnership with Doximity. So this foundation gives flights up to $2,000 for any volunteers going to Tanzania for 2 weeks. And they've funded almost 10 of our volunteers, and that is, we're really, really grateful for that. You see, Burlington Medical are the ones who gave us the lead aprons, Cook Medical gave us some supplies. SIR is a big, big supporter, and again, from an institutional point, they act as the Royal Colleges here, and they're actually a big source for actual physicians who go to Tanzania. And RAD is a good, big volunteer organization that allows us to source both the IR nurses and IR technologists. Again, there are many, many moving parts to this. Yes, if we had funding, it would be so much easier. Right now, we know that with Airbnb, I can house 5 people in a 3-bedroom apartment for $80 a day in Dar es Salaam, and it's super comfortable. For those who know Dar es Salaam, this is called Viva Towers, which is basically right opposite Serena Hotel. Very comfortable, you're looking over the Chimicana and the ocean. It's really awesome. All right. So, final pitch. Why should you even bother to do this? Why should the Royal College of Radiology want to like do this? So, this is just to kind of boil it down. Does it have value to the U.S. institutions? I can mention many values, but this is a couple, one of them. Me and everybody else who works in advanced systems always forgets how awesome it is to work in an awesome, basically, highly advanced systems, right? I go to my station right now, if the mouse doesn't work, I start complaining, right? So we're so used to like everything working like clockwork, right? So when you go to these environments where everything is a bit of a struggle, actually allows you when you come back, you can have a lot of gratitude. Another thing that happens to us is burnout in the US and probably in the UK, where people are working super hard and tend to forget the joy that they had in going into the specialty. Again, going on these trips allows you to basically remember what it's like actually just to be a radiologist and why you're really actually super needed. And lastly, you get to knock off 2 things off your bucket list: Ngorongoro Crater and Zanzibar, by going to Tanzania on this trip. So again, I really thank you for your attention. I'm sorry I ran over time, but thank you so much.
So Frank has just given us a brilliant demonstration of how speaking works.